My name is Jamila Rizvi. I'm a News Limited columnist, a presenter for the ABC, and mandatory political disclosure, a member of the Australian Labor Party, and a very proud board member of the Melbourne Writers Festival. Do we live in a shrinking democracy? Gillian Triggs, the president of the Australian Human Rights Commission, believes that Parliament is failing in protecting fundamental human rights and freedoms in Australia. Former Foreign Minister and Premier of New South Wales, Bob Carr, says that despite the fracturing party systems, parliamentary democracy remains our very best option. If the big decisions of a democracy are made by those who show up, then the early marks taken by those in our federal parliament last night suggest we are in for a whole lot of trouble. But several hundred of you are here on a Friday afternoon giving up your time to have a yarn about democracy, and I think that says some pretty good things. So let's find out some more. We have the tremendous hour of debate and discussion ahead of us. We'll start from hearing from both Bob and Gillian, who will each present us with a short address, and then we'll move to the discussion phase of the afternoon, where I will do my very, very best to ensure we touch on the many current issues that we have facing us as a nation. This is a topic large enough for approximately 100 PhD theses, so an hour isn't going to be enough to cut it. We shall endeavour nonetheless. Bob has also informed me that he doesn't believe in rules and doesn't read instructions. So it's going to be one hell of an afternoon. Let's get cracking. Bob Carr is Australia's former Minister for Foreign Affairs and the longest serving Premier of New South Wales history. Following his resignation from the Senate in 2013, the University of Technology Sydney appointed him to lead the Australia-China Relations Institute, a think tank dedicated to Australia-China relations. His latest book is called Diary of a Foreign Minister, and it is very much worth getting your hands on a copy, and Bob will be available after this event to sign copies if you don't have one already. As you'd expect, the book provides substantial policy analysis and brilliant insight into the political process from a man who really has seen it all. But Bob is also a master wordsmith. Two of my favourite moments in the book are when Bob describes the Washington Embassy's fascination with the Bradley Manning trial as espionage erotica, and labels the opening line of a phone call from New South Wales power broker Sam Dastyari, who always begins every politically difficult conversation with mate, mate, as the mating call of the New South Wales right. Here today, though, to talk to us about the role of a modern parliamentary democracy and the seemingly widespread dissatisfaction with our current political leadership. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together and welcome Bob Carr.
I'm delighted to be on a platform with such a single-minded survivor as Gillian Triggs, and delighted to be at the Writers' Festival. When I was Sam Dastyari's age, my own version of a brash young politician, I'd completed a few years as Minister for Planning and Environment in Neville Rand's government. We're coming up to the election that would see us defeated. I was in my electorate. There were a couple of days to go to polling day. I was walking up a hill at Maroubra. I saw a mature aged man coming down the hill with a walking stick. I thought, in my brashness and narcissism as a young politician, I'd fix him with an irresistible smile and secure at least one vote. Good morning, sir, I said. And quick as a flash, he said, it'll be goodbye on Saturday. So that's the... I've always remembered that as the great... a hint of the great purgative effect of Australian democracy. And sure enough, within 3 days, I was there with packing cases in my ministerial office. I got to say, I had the decency to ring the incoming minister and wish him well. The genius of a free people is what's produced a system where in Australia we've accepted the democratic outcome without, unlike Argentina or Chile, other European states planted in the southern hemisphere, without a coup or riots in the street, without a military takeover. That's the genius of the Australian people. The first election for a colonial legislature was in 1857. The people vote. If you get a majority of seats in the lower house, you and your team take government. If you don't, you go. The Americans voted out their first president in the election of 1800. And the newly minted White House, built by slaves, was vacated by John Adams, and Thomas Jefferson moved in. That's it was the genius of people after millennia of rule by kings and tyrants to settle on a different landing. The system is flawed. The system lets us down. Yes, questions of trust. We can be full of bile and grievance about how it works. A lot of it is about not getting the outcome we want. But Churchill's advice rings true. Worst possible system of government apart from every other one that's been tried. The challenge is to come up with ideas in a forum like this or elsewhere about what we do. This can be a gripe session about what's wrong with the system. If so, nothing will change. Or we can lay out on that table ideas for making it better. But in the meantime, let's not get in to that old resort that the thing to save democracy is the man on the white horse, the man above party, the man above faction, who, like Napoleon, will come in, disband the legislature, and make wise decisions worthy of a philosopher king. Donald Trump is offering that at the present time. He's a non-politician. Well, that's fantastic. Two Boston politicians, John F. Kennedy and Robert Kennedy, saved us from a nuclear exchange in 1962 over the Cuban Missile Crisis, when their military were recommending a nuclear exchange. I haven't got the confidence that Donald Trump, the non-politician, has got the judgment to make a decision like that in a crisis like that. Beware of people who are speaking in a sort of, quote, dictator envy, unquote. Yet democracy is full of contradictions. In my last month as foreign minister, Assad of Syria had lobbed chemical weapons at his own people, barrel bombing with chemical weapons. Obama said, who wouldn't support him, in principle at least, I want to punish him. I want retaliatory strikes. He couldn't win his Congress. He was checked by his Congress. And Cameron, offering his parliament at Westminster a range of choices, went down to a big defeat. The House of Commons said no. Nothing can be done. Who was right? Who was wrong? But they're the checks and balances of messy parliamentary democracy. Democracy is always a mess. And the voters are always dissatisfied. That's why they vote governments in and vote them out. And look at the Northern Territory. Seem to be doing it with greater frequency. But the myth that there's a man on a white charger who can come in and fix the system up reminds me of the story about the German woman in the middle of the wreckage in Hamburg in the Second World War, looking at what had become of a beautiful city, saying, oh, what a crisis. Still, thank God we've got Hitler. We'd be in a real fix without a strong leader. Another challenge. The challenge of globalization. I spoke in Curry Curry Church Hall a week ago, little Curry Curry in the Hunter Valley. You come from Curry Curry. Beautiful town in the Hunter Valley, a coal mining town. And I spoke to a Labor bunch there, and I said, this is the challenge we've got. Pauline Hanson got elected with colleagues because she said, we've lost industrial jobs, we can bring them back with protection. And Nick Xenophon, on a higher plane, he's further up the food chain than Pauline. Nick Xenophon offered something like that security to the voters of South Australia. I said a big political party that is either going to be in government or providing the alternative government can't do that. We can't tell people that ramming up tariff barriers, returning to the levels we had in the 70s, is going to bring back car manufacturing when China itself is getting out of old-fashioned car and shoe and T-shirt manufacturers and making drones and other more sophisticated products. Pauline can go there, and more sophisticated economic populists can go there and hint that they can do it, but I've got to tell you, it's not possible. And the major political parties can't offer the illusion that Donald Trump can offer in the United States. I'll bring back your jobs. Globalization will end. I'll bring the jobs back from China. It's a lie. It can't be done. The old jobs aren't coming back. But part of the gripe against contemporary politics feeds off the myth that it can happen. Democracy is give and take. As Premier, I restricted people's rights. The right to carry a knife on you. I gave the police the power to search you and remove it, subject to certain controls. Anti-terrorism laws. The right of police in a gazetted emergency to stop cars and search them in the wake of September 11. I gave the police commissioner to sack people he thought were corrupt, lacked his confidence. I removed the right of police to protection from unfair dismissal in the public interest, removal of rights in the public interest. It's give and take. But at the same time, we gave same-sex couples equal access to protection under the rights of inheritance and hospital access in an emergency that meant a great deal in the law of the time, and equal rights in superannuation. We brought transgender people under the New South Wales Anti-Discrimination Act. We gave whistleblowers protected disclosure to the satisfaction of Jeffrey Robertson, so I thought it must have been A-class legislation. We gave the victims of asbestos-related disease the opportunity to sue James Hardy by hauling them back into the country and sticking them in the dock. I'm opposed to a Charter of Rights. People who advocate a Charter of Rights assume all the judges in the future interpreting your rights are going to be Michael Kirby's. But they may not be. They may be judges appointed by Attorney General Corey Bernardi in a government led by Prime Minister Peter Dutton. And how they will interpret freedom of association or freedom of speech frightens me. I'd leave it to the give and take of your judgment at elections, rather than entrust it to the High Court with expanded opportunities for judicial review. Perhaps we can talk about that later. I'm worried about liberal intolerance, because I think the delicate balance we've got in our system can be threatened if the advocates of so-called progressive positions push too far. For example, I was with a Labor candidate in the last federal election on a street corner, facing a voter, a Chinese background voter with a child in a pram, saying, "I'm worried about the Safe Schools package. Why should my son or daughter have to dress up in the clothes of the other gender? Or use one another's toilets?" Later I said to our candidate, "Surely that's not part of the package." She said, "We need to counter it because it's in some of the material." Now, I haven't had time to check it. What I stand for is the most robust and effective anti-homophobic bullying material that we can get into the school system with consensus support, so it entrenches itself as part of the ethos of every school. Why introduce distracting or inflammatory material? For example, telling teachers they've got to move away from using the expression boys and girls. Why tackle that? Why sign up for that social engineering instead of sticking to the position, effective anti-homophobic bullying in a package that all shades of opinion have got to support? The other example is this, and I hope I'm being thought-provoking, I don't think this is provocative, and this is not a criticism of the Human Rights Commission, far from it. I support 18C, and I draw your attention to the excellent defence of it presented by that terrific advocate, Waheed Ali, in the Fairfax Press today. I agree with every word of it. I would defend 18C anywhere. But haven't we got a problem when students at university end up facing heavy legal bills for expressing a view? To me, this appears to be the case. I might be mistaken. But if we create martyrs for the opponents of 18C, aren't we making something controversial that should be now a consensus position? That is, a position against racially motivated attacks. I want to build consensus around these positions, not make them questionable or divisive. The way you advance in a social reform agenda is to move, build support, and then take the next move. Build support for your position and lead people to reform. You can be ambitious. I championed a medically supervised injecting room, and it remains the only one in Australia. It saved the lives of people dependent on heroin, and I sold that to the New South Wales electorate. Don't tell me that democracy can't tolerate challenging ideas. If explained properly, with all the details nailed down, a political leader can do it. In this spirit, I'm strongly opposed to us embarking on religious vilification laws. The prospect of us hindering someone's right to criticise a religious community only invites a backlash. Remember those pastors who held opinions I'd never defend, who were prosecuted in Victoria a decade ago? They became martyrs for expressing views about another religion. That's a mistake of the liberal imagination, small L liberal imagination. I'm talking about a phenomenon of liberal intolerance here that's been remarked on in the US and which we should guard against. I conclude with this. Isaiah Berlin, one of the greatest thinkers on politics, mounted a defence of messy democracy. Messy democracy. The spirit of that bloke who walked down the street saw me as his local state member, you know, proud of being a minister in the Rand government, a 38-year-old minister, and said, he said, it'll be goodbye next Saturday. I'm voting you out. You know, the cheeky spirit of an Australian Democrat, proving one thing. It's the ethos of a country that keeps it free. The ethos of a country that keeps it free. The spirit of the people. Not a charter of rights that simply sends things into the courts to be determined, but the spirit of the people saying, I don't have to have a reason to vote you out. I'm sick of your bloody face and the tone of your voice. I'm voting against you next Saturday. It's that spirit that keeps us free, and the knowledge that when a government steps too far, the support of a sceptical electorate, a sceptical and intelligent electorate, gets withdrawn. We've seen several governments in that position, perhaps right now in New South Wales, but this is what Isaiah Berlin said, defending liberal democracy. He said, a liberal sermon which recommends machinery designed to prevent people from doing each other too much harm, giving each human group sufficient room to realise its own idiosyncratic, unique, particular ends without too much interference with the ends of others. It's not a passionate battle cry to inspire men to sacrifice and martyrdom and heroic feats, unquote. There's no heroic battle cry in defending creaky old, disappointing democracy. But it's got its virtues, including the right of the people to vote the rulers out. And we went for millennia without people being entrusted with that right. We've had that right for about 200 years. We're particularly good at it in Australia. No coups, no men on white horses galloping down Collins Street to take over the government. It's the genius of the Australian people. But for God's sake, let's focus on practical plans for improvement, not engage in a generalised whinge, because that comes cheap. It's too easy. As Bernard Crick, a great political scientist, said, the rage of people at their politicians is the rage of Caliban in Shakespeare's Tempest, seeing his own reflection in the water. Think on that and be constructive. Thank you.
I counted six policy grenades in that 10 minutes, so I think it's going to be a good discussion session. Emeritus Professor Gillian Triggs was Dean of the Faculty of Law and Chalice Professor of International Law at the University of Sydney from 2007 to 2012 and Director of the British Institute of International and Comparative Law from 2005 to 2007. She is a former barrister and governor of the College of Law, and she is currently President of Australia's Human Rights Commission. Professor Triggs's focus at the Commission is on the implementation in Australian law of the human rights treaties to which Australia is a party, and to work with nations in the Asia-Pacific region on practical approaches to human rights. She is the author of many books and papers on international law, some of which I read at university and did not understand. not because they weren't very good books. Gillian has said just this week that we should be both alert and alarmed to the degree to which human rights are being eroded in Australia. She has said, and I quote, that Australia has become isolated and exceptional in its approach to the protection of human rights. And she doesn't mean that in a good way. Here to talk to us today about the role of the Parliament in safeguarding fundamental human rights and freedoms, ladies and gentlemen, Gillian Triggs.
Well, thank you very much for that introduction, and you seem to have managed very well without understanding my books. You did introduce me as Emeritus Professor Gillian Triggs, and indeed I am an Emeritus Professor, and a not very good friend of mine told me the other day that that is Latin for has been. There's some truth in that. But at least my 50 years as a practicing lawyer qualifies me to make some of the statements that I'm about to make now. Well, our topic today is, of course, a shrinking democracy, and it's been dramatically illustrated by the debacle we've seen in Canberra just yesterday. While federal parliament has not sat for over 4 months, the first sitting week was for a mere 3 days. Our politicians were leaving with indecent haste for the airport on Thursday afternoon, giving the Labour Party the opportunity to defeat a majority government on the floor of the House for the first time in 54 years. There are many questions that one might ask arising from this. What is the role of Parliament in modern government? Has Parliament become surplus to needs other than for passing bills of supply or new laws? Is Parliament fit for purpose in defending democracy? Well, I suggest that ever since the beginnings of representative democracy, Parliament has been a traditional bulwark against the power of the sovereign and executive government from the time of the Magna Carta and King John, forced by the feudal barons to sign that remarkable instrument. But over the last 15 years or so, respective federal and some state parliaments have seriously failed to protect our common law freedoms, and they've ignored the international human rights treaties that Australia played such a leadership role in negotiating and signing. This might go right back, of course, to the Magna Carta, and I mention in particular in the middle of this amazing document, which gives you the measurement of a glass of wine and how broad the piece of cloth is and the rights of widows on the deaths of their husband, an extraordinary provision. No man may be detained arbitrarily without trial or charge by his peers, along with other provisions of freedom of religion, speech, and assembly. These are not inventions of the United Nations over the last few years, but they are deeply embedded principles that underpin our modern democracy. But sadly, Australian parliaments have been in retreat from our historical commitment to freedoms and human rights, and they've willingly granted executives unprecedented powers outside wartime. Governments have been in lockstep with opposition parties over issues such as the stripping of citizenship and 501 visas, access by security agencies to your metadata without a judicially approved warrant, offshore processing of refugees in conditions that the United Nations says breaches the Convention Against Torture, and counter-terrorism laws which breach most of Australia's international obligations and ancient principles of the common law. As respective federal parliaments have become increasingly fractured and dysfunctional, with the result that governments cannot achieve their legislative objectives, the risks of government by executive fiat, by regulation, and by the exercise of ministerial discretion pose ever-increasing threats to our democracy. But let me give you some practical examples, because they're rather lofty ideas. What does that mean by reference to the laws that are being passed, very often 2 weeks before Christmas, over the last few years? Parliament has passed laws with the compliance and complicity of opposition parties under the Migration Act, so that Australia is the only country in the world to mandate the indefinite detention of asylum seekers. There are very few grounds on which indefinite detention can be challenged before our courts, and our courts have been locked out of a judicial review of those decisions. And a very interesting example, which I think underpins the problem and the place we're in Australia at the moment, is that two or three months ago, we had a unanimous decision of the Papua New Guinea Supreme Court that detention on Manus Island violates their constitutional right to liberty. Just a few weeks before that, we had a 6-1 decision of the Australian High Court that sending asylum seekers to Nauru is constitutionally valid under our constitution. Wherein lies the difference? How is it that a modern constitution in Papua New Guinea can reach the right results on liberty, reflecting that provision in the Magna Carta, but we're not able to achieve that under our own constitution? Last year, Parliament introduced the concept of a legacy caseload act. Legacy, of course, applies to both parliaments, but this was a statement by one, which removed references to the Refugee Convention so that the definition of a refugee reflects the government or the minister's subjective view of that law rather than international law. The fast-track processing for assessing refugee status, a very misleading title because we now have something like 30,000 asylum seekers in Australia whose claims have not been met, denies any right of appeal to an independent judge. Counter-terrorism laws are now said to be so disproportionate that we're accused internationally of hyper-legislating with more than three times the number of counter-terrorism laws than the United States and the United Kingdom. Parliament has failed to deal with criticisms of Section 18C of the Race Discrimination Act, and the Prime Minister and the attorneys, or the former Prime Minister and the attorneys' efforts to reform the provision were so extreme and so out of line with any international or national standards as to be bound to fail. The reforms were withdrawn and the decision was made that there are weightier priorities for government. Parliament has also failed to provide leadership on the question of marriage equality. The key freedom of that is that of equality before the law. In this case, the same rights under the Marriage Act as have all other Australians. Parliament has squibbed the issue. We now have a political commitment to a plebiscite that will not be binding on Parliament. It will be expensive, divisive, and potentially harmful. In principle, representative Parliament should vote on the issue, and we should not have a popular vote on fundamental freedoms. In the past, Parliament has made decisions about the equal rights of women to education, the rights of the aged and the disabled to employment and public access, or the protections under the Race Discrimination Act. Why, we must ask, is it necessary for a popular vote on the equal right to civil marriage? And I'd suggest that that popular vote is in itself a deeply discriminatory idea when all other rights and freedoms are matters for Parliament. A final example concerns the Northern Territory Parliament's laws on paperless arrest. Under these laws, introduced a couple of years ago, a policeman can arrest a person and hold them for up to 4 hours without taking them to a magistrate as soon as is practicable, contrary to one of the most basic principles of criminal justice of millennia heritage. Indeed, in the second reading speech for the paperless arrest laws, one of the reasons given by the Northern Territory was that they wanted to ensure that the police didn't have to waste their time on paperwork. Quite an extraordinary idea that was not really something that had much of an impact until we saw that iconic picture of a hooded young man in a physical restraint held in isolation for unconscionable periods of time. It's interesting that it's the iconic image that gets us going these days. My generation, certainly in the 60s, the iconic image was of that young girl running down the street in Vietnam with napalm bombs, burns. 2 or 3 years ago, it was the young four-year-old on a Turkish beach, a crumpled loss. We saw the picture of a little boy in an orange ambulance seat from Syria against figures of thousands of children being killed. He was actually one of the lucky ones. And now we see the CCTV footage of these restraints. Sadly, the paperless arrest laws and laws like it are ones which ensure that we have a grossly disproportionate impact of laws on Aboriginal Australians. 95% of youths in detention in the Northern Territory are Aboriginal, and about 55% nationally are Aboriginal. These are disgraceful figures, and the United Nations has just reported that they are the worst levels of Indigenous incarceration in the world. And these kinds of incarceration rates occur despite, you might recall, 25 years ago, the Royal Commission into Aboriginal Deaths in Custody. Now we have twice the number of Aboriginal Australians in custody, and the deaths are occurring weekly. And we indeed, in Darwin, just a few days ago, yet another added to this list. The tragedy then is that these laws are unconscionable, they are illegal, and they are reported upon over and over again. I have reported on those physical restraints to Parliament, in particular 2 years ago, arguing that they were in breach of the rights of these Indigenous young men in the Northern Territory. I visited the attorney to express my concerns about the use of these physical restraints. And my report was tabled in Parliament by the attorney with the words, "I hereby table these reports," attracting no media attention. And the head of the Legal and Constitutional Committee has said he is too busy to read any of my reports, including the Forgotten Children report. That is the Parliament and the kind of Parliament that we have allowed to happen in an isolated environment in Canberra. The Australian public is sleepwalking into a situation in which we have an executive government that is largely out of control. Why is it out of control? It's out of control because we're exceptionalist in Australia, indeed almost unique for comparable legal systems. We have very few constitutional protections. We have the right to vote, the right to freedom of religion, the right to trial by jury on indictment, and the High Court implies a right of political communication, but that's it. We're the only common law country in the world without a Bill of Rights. You might note that the United States Supreme Court, ultimately, because Congress was unable to do it, ultimately the United States Supreme Court resolved the problem of the of marriage equality based on the 14th Amendment right of equality before the law. We have no Bill of Rights against which our courts can determine whether our practices are valid or not. And hence, we come back to the comparison with a Papua New Guinea with a modern constitution that has clear provisions in its laws against which our courts are able to, or their courts are able to determine whether an act is in breach of fundamental principles. The international treaties to which Australia is a party have, for the most part, not been implemented into domestic law. So that we go into the international environment and we have a wonderful time negotiating these treaties and we have the red carpet and the cameras flashing and we sign the treaties, but they don't, and they have not been implemented by Parliament into Australian domestic law, which is why our judges are not able to do what the judge in Papua New Guinea can do or what the Supreme Court judges can do. It has become a parlous situation. But one where we might say Australia has opted for a parliamentary process to protect our human rights. And one of the most important reforms that I thought we were going to have was the Parliamentary Scrutiny Committee introduced in 2011. But that committee has been extremely disappointing in breaking down along party lines. So, and not only does it break down along party lines, rather than standing up for the core principles, but it reports after the legislation has been passed on the House and Senate floors. So it has really been an extremely disappointing process. Well, may I finish by saying that let us not forget that Australia is seeking a seat on the United Nations Human Rights Council in November next year. The international community has long voiced its concerns about the treatment of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islanders, about the treatment of asylum seekers and refugees, of their mandatory and indefinite detention. I'd suggest that the failure of Parliament to protect these rights and the inability of the courts to reach out to benchmark provisions means that we now need to give, yet again, serious consideration to a legislated Bill of Rights. Yes, of course, a Bill of Rights gives judges the power to interpret those provisions. But where do you think the common law rights and our freedoms came from? They came from judges in the 12th and 13th and 14th and 15th centuries. It was our judges who articulated these rights. We have quite a conservative, very highly regarded judiciary in Australia. I do not think that with a Bill of Rights, they're suddenly going to run amok. New Zealand, for example, has had a Bill of Rights for 21 years, and only once in 21 years has the High Court or Supreme Court there ever ruled that legislation was contrary to the Bill of Rights and therefore should be reconsidered by Parliament. These are not radical proposals, but we need to stop this slide into isolation, to take some note of the international legal standards and to understand that we need to be part of the international community in relation to the way in which we achieve our democratic outcomes. We're a very successful multicultural society, and we need to stand up for provisions like 18C and D. We need to stand up for fair treatment of those who seek our protection, and we need very seriously to try to understand better why so many of our young Indigenous Australians are incarcerated, contrary to even the most basic of rights. Thank you all very much.
I moderate a few of these panels, and this is going to be the hardest session of moderating questions I think we've ever had. There were so many issues in what you both just spoke about, but I'm going to try and draw together what I thought were a few points of comparison which might be worth unpacking. The first is that, Bob, you spoke about consensus building and the importance of progressives not pushing their agenda too far ahead of the rest of the population. And then, Gillian, you spoke about, to an extent, the dangers of consensus when we have the two major parties aligning in the parliament and letting issues almost go unnoticed. And our Prime Minister has spoken extensively in the last couple of months about the sensible centre and the importance of the sensible centre. And yet, on the other hand, when we see a departure from our parliamentarians voting on party lines, we are talking about groups like Bernardi's New Conservative Group, which doesn't seem to give an outcome that is necessarily going to be one that protects human rights anyway. So to me, that says they've got two very different positions here, one that says consensus will help us forge ahead, and one that says consensus is something to be nervous about. I was hoping you might be able to speak to that a little further.
Well, one of the problems with this debate is that when you put it in terms of consensus and parliament and democracy, it all sounds wonderful. The trouble is it doesn't work or isn't working at the moment. And I think one of the problems is really very poor leadership across the parties. Although, from my background, I've always believed in grassroots, that if you can get the community to respond to issues, then you can have an impact on your politicians and have an impact on Parliament. And that remains true, but I've become much more aware over the last four and a bit years of my presidency of the Commission that leadership is vital. And I completely agree with Bob when he finished, and I think that was a great note on which to finish. And that is that ultimately the freedoms and the rights and the values that underpin Australian society depend on the ethos and on the culture. And that gets you part of the way. But if your leaders reject that culture, it's very, very hard for the public to maintain those values. And if I give you an example, when we had the rapporteur of the United Nations say that the conditions in our detention centres, particularly Manus, Nauru and Christmas Island, were, in his view, in breach of the Convention on Torture, and we had the High Commissioner for Human Rights reflecting those views, our former Prime Minister said, "We will not be lectured to by the United Nations." Now, the difficulty with that is that without strong leadership to stand up for the values that have been so important for Australia, it's very hard to maintain that ethos and culture in Australia. So consensus can be wonderful and it can be effective, but it can also be extremely dangerous. And that is why you need laws and independent judiciaries to guard against the tyranny of the majority. And these collusions, because of the political needs, to leave no daylight whatever between what the Labor Party and the coalition is saying on, for example, offshore processing.
King James Version. Ecclesiastes. A time for this and a time for that. Time for this, a time for that. Time for consensus and a time for a bold position that says, here we stand, we can do no other. This way we vote. I think consensus is useful when you're leading people to do something that hasn't been done before. The example I quoted was a decisive statement for the schools against homophobic bullying. It makes sense to expand support for that so that it settles into place in every last school around the nation and everyone can sign up to it. A time for taking a stand? Parliament ought to vote on same-sex marriage and get it off the agenda. I was able to participate in a vote in the Senate in favour of the recognition of the status of same-sex marriages concluded overseas in the Australian jurisdiction. No big deal. This should have been voted on some years ago. I'm not advocating consensus on that, waiting for an American census that brings all sides together. I mean, in politics, sometimes the leader's got to say, this is where we stand. We'll die or fall by this. When the waterfront employers sack workers in Sydney, in the wharves in Sydney, simply because they belong to a union, I knew that the position we took as a state government to stand with the workers who are picketing the wharves would have us demonised in the popular media. But for God's sake, the Labor Party was formed in a maritime dispute in 1891 on the very same principle. We had no alternative. There's no talk about building a consensus there with ruthless waterfront employers trying to get a union-free workforce.
So if there seems to be the consensus between the two of you, to use the word consensus here, is seems to be that the political leadership is vital. Are our current political leaders up to the job?
The term I use, and a lot of people will take offence at it, is, and I grew up learning the craft of politics under someone I thought who was very good at it, Premier Neville Wran. This is before anyone here was born, so you wouldn't remember him. But I settle on this word. I thought in the Gillard government, while I greatly admired her and admired for the most part the agenda the government stood for, I wanted to see some Rand-style nimble-footed leadership. And that's the adjective I'd use. Shakespeare has Falstaff refer to the nimble-footed Prince of Wales in Henry IV. And I would settle on that. I, as a Labour rank and filer in the old days, I wanted our leaders to be able to out-debate the other side and win for progressive positions. As a young Whitlamite, that's why I cheered on Gough, because he could dominate in Parliament. I'm sure you had the same feeling. You know, Whitlam just commanding the Parliament. I love that, putting the case for a progressive agenda, winning on the value of his ideas and the excitement of his eloquence. And that's what I want to see in our political leaders. If they can sell a case, if they can sell a case well, they'll have the confidence to adopt the case. They'll have a good political leader. You know, now I'm interested in American political history. I think of a Franklin Roosevelt. Only he could have sold the case in the dark days of 1940 for America's first peacetime draft. And he did it by cunning. He did it with all the sense of a fox. It was cunning that got that up. I want to see skillful political leadership. If our leaders are skillful at their craft, and politics is a craft, then they're more confident at selling the occasional unpopular, provocative, challenging, but good policy position.
I want to ask about the filtering down of the kind of political rhetoric and almost entertainment value and the ability to persuade that you're talking about there. Because it seems to me, when I look at some of the biggest human rights abuses that Gillian mentioned, so the Dondale Juvenile Detention Facility and what we've seen through the Nauru files that The Guardian published recently, is that you've got a rhetoric that happens at the top, at this policy-making political level, that is filtering down, not just in a legislative or a regulatory way, but that the people on the ground who are implementing the rules, so I'm talking about guards and people who work for the companies that we're employing to run these organisations, that they are affected by the rhetoric of the top. If the rhetoric of the top is harsh, does that send a message even beyond the lawmaking or the rules that they're working within, that they should also be harsh in the way that they work?
Yes, well, that's exactly my point about when you have a Prime Minister who says, you know, disregard these rules, or where you have a leader of a party in the Northern Territory introducing these laws late last year, that came into force this year, to hold youths in those steel chairs. That was law passed by Parliament deliberately to restrain these children. But when you have leaders who put that sort of view out, then that makes it very difficult to get a culture of respect for basic dignity and human rights. I think the point might also be made that the people who are running these camps, detention centres, are very, very badly trained. And you might notice that just in the last few days, an audit of the International Health and Medical Services that earn billions of dollars for running the offshore processing centres have just received a $300,000 fine for failure to meet every one of their key indicators for provision of good health, with the exception of one. So it's a problem that flows through the whole system. Mm. You've got big companies making money out of these services, ill-trained staff, and you've got senior politicians putting a law and order argument and passing law through a compliant parliament for this to occur. But I wonder if I could just finish by saying, just to answer the other question about leadership. Because I think we are, you've raised the Trump phenomenon. I think we're actually in quite a good position in Australia at the moment. We have Mr. Turnbull and Mr. Shorten, who I think are decent human beings. They are head-to-head in a very, very difficult political environment. But I believe that it would be possible for them to agree that offshore processing has been so divisive, so cruel, so expensive, and ultimately unsustainable, that just imagine if they were to agree between them that this is a policy that they could change and do so in a way where neither was getting political benefit from the other. It's possible, and with good people and goodwill, you could do it. And I really throw out the challenge to them to do it. Sorry, Bob. Yeah. Thank you.
Two quick points. I think to complete the picture on the Northern Territory, it'd be appropriate, Gillian, for you to say that the people of the Northern Territory deserve credit because they seem to have evaluated this. They seem to have been appalled and offended by what was being done in their name. And in a part of Australia, which a lot of people in the southeastern corner would have seen as redneck Australia, they voted the mob out. Emphatically. There was a huge shift in popular support, and this issue seemed to be an issue that figured in it. So the picture needs to be, the circle needs to be closed by giving credit to the system and the voters of the Northern Territory for taking this into their hands. On the other thing, the challenge to both sides of politics, I speak as a supporter of offshore processing and detention. It's a majority Australian position. And having thousands of people arrive each month brought by people smugglers was intolerable with all the deaths at sea. But for God's sake, it's a system that ought to be able to be run with all the wit of the Australian people in a humane manner. And clearly we've got the option, taking further Gillian's point that she's just made, of having both sides of Australian politics, if it is the acceptable position, to say the remaining asylum seekers will come here, given what's happened, combined with this, that both sides of politics say offshore processing and resettlement, combined with boat turnbacks, continue indefinitely, because you need that to send a message to the people smuggling business that operates in ports in South Asia. They cannot resume their awful trade.
Is achieving that kind of political consensus, whether it's along the lines of what you've spoken of there, Bob, we're here discussing democracy, so we're going to give a go to the people have paid to see, or whether what Gillian said just before, is it realistic? Like, is, you know, my picture of Malcolm and Bill sitting in a room and going, we're going to do the right thing for the country, as opposed to point score on this issue that's divided us for 15 years.
Okay, I'm a veteran politician, so excuse me for drawing on my own experiences. But gun control in New South Wales and later at the national level following gun massacres was a case in point. As opposition leader, I said to the Greiner government, after a massacre at Strathfield, we will back you. We'll give you total support on the package. We'll work with you on a parliamentary committee to conclude it. We won't do, I don't think I was this rude, but I implied we wouldn't do what he had done to a Labor government in 1988, go round and rally the support of gun owners in rural New South Wales to take seats off the then Unsworth government. And that was an example of a big mopping up in gun ownership in New South Wales, and it provided a model for Howard after what happened in Port Arthur. Support from both sides of Parliament enabled a government to take guns off gun-owning recreational shooters, as they call themselves, to get semi-automatics and automatics out of the Australian scene. And that was a huge advance, and it was buttressed by a political consensus. So it can happen, and it's in the interest of both sides to have those hard decisions done. I hope that budget repair... I don't want to see Australia become a country spoken of around the world as having a chronic problem of public debt and wall-to-wall deficits. The Prime Minister is right when he says this is a burden on future generations, and the frontbench of the Labor Party wouldn't disagree with that diagnosis. I think there's an opportunity for both sides of politics to come together and say, here's a bare minimum of budget repair measures, we can agree on it, and on the Labor side, there'd be an appreciation, I hope, that if this process commences now, when the political cycle turns and Labor's in government, a lot of the work will have been set in place in the spirit of what you're urging on a different problem.
Would a legislative bill or charter of rights be what we need in terms of a circuit breaker to set in stone sort of the fundamental human rights that Australia believes in, to sort of provide that guidance, not just at the top, but to create that ethos and sense of community? And I know there's a difference of opinion here, so
yes,
we're going to start
no.
here.
Yes, no.
We'll start with Gillian.
Well, I've thought long and hard about this, and I know Bob has too, and he makes some very good points. But I think... And there's never, it's rarely black and white. It's on balance what seems. But I think because we've had so many egregious breaches of human rights over the last 15 years in so many areas, I've come to the view ultimately that we need a legislated bill, a bit like New Zealand's. If we don't get it quite right, well, then you amend the legislation. It's not concreted into place. But it allows us to give our courts an opportunity to... to have a benchmark. And perhaps I could make the point that a colleague of mine, George Williams, a marvellous constitutional lawyer, I'm sure you all know him, did a survey a few years ago, and he asked Australians, the survey number, do we have a constitution? And 60% said no. He then said, do we have a Bill of Rights? And 80% said yes. And about the same time, when I was... looking at these figures, I was conscious that somebody had been arrested in Western Australia for killing his wife. Unfortunately, a phenomenon that we're all in despair about, the domestic violence. But on being arrested by the police, he said he would take the Fifth Amendment. Now, the problem is, as I see it, that one of the reasons why, if I may say so, Bob can get away with his argument that we don't need a Bill of Rights and we'll have this activist judiciary that's going to run amok with our laws, is that we have so little education about our constitution and our rights. We do not know. If you ask an American 8-year-old or 10-year-old what the First Amendment is, they know exactly what it is. Freedom of speech. You ask an Australian child about our constitution, or a teenager, or a 20-year-old, absolutely no idea. No idea at all, unless they're, if there are any students here who are doing legal studies or studying it at the university. But this is a shame for Australia, because one reason politicians have got away with this very high level of executive overreach and discretion for ministers that is not amenable to court determination and judicial review, is that the public isn't aware of how their rights are being infringed. And I'm very concerned that with the current dysfunctional parliament and parliaments, we're going to have governments relying more than ever on these executive powers that you can't see operating. They're all working in Canberra. You won't know that it's happening until something goes wrong. So I really now believe that we have to have a national debate about a Bill of Rights that would be legislated, easily amended, but would start to set some standards by which our young Australians understand their rights and politicians understand that they too, through Parliament, are subject to those rights and that they are not autonomous, autocratic bodies that can do precisely what they like.
I blame too many seasons of Law and Order. But
yeah,
Bob?
Yeah. America, of course, had a Bill of Rights, not a week-old Charter of Rights, but a Bill of Rights, the first 10 amendments of its Constitution, for 100 years and American blacks did not get the vote. America's got a Bill of Rights, 100 years, 100 years with that illustrious American Bill of Rights. It didn't get American blacks, liberated slaves after 1865, the right to vote. It took another 100 years. America's got a Bill of Rights, yeah, terrific, using the sort of language that Gillian and other advocates would want for us. Explain how useful that is to the Americans on death row. America's got capital punishment protected by its Supreme Court. So I think that exempts any country from a claim, removes from any country the claim to be a leader on human rights. Here's an example. I debated this with Michael Kirby. He said, a Charter of Rights is the only way you'd protect the rights of Muslim Australians. The next week I open the paper and read that France, which is covered by the European Charter of Rights, is stripping Muslims in France of the right to wear Islamic dress. A proposition that Australia, with no Charter of Rights, never embraced. I don't want conservative judges, as I said earlier, the sort that might be appointed by a conservative government in the future, interpreting what freedom of speech means. Because in Canada, where they have a Charter of Rights, their Supreme Court interpreted freedom of speech to mean the freedom to advertise tobacco products. And in the United States, where freedom of speech is the First Amendment to the Constitution, the first article in their Bill of Rights, the Supreme Court interpreted freedom of speech to mean that Congress had to be overruled in banning huge donations by the billionaire class to American politicians. So there's Congress trying to reform the donation laws in America, because we all know American politics is corrupted systemically by big money, and the Supreme Court says, no, can't do that. We've got a Bill of Rights in this country. And banning the donation of money to political parties, yes, even the billions that the Koch brothers put in and the Sheldon Adelson pours into the Republicans, you can't do that. Congress has got no right to do that. An elected Congress has got no right to restrain that, because we've got freedom of speech in our Constitution. Now, they're the distortions and the contradictions you get once you come down from the heights and say, here we have chiseled in stone a Charter of Rights, a Bill of Rights. What do they mean? What do these concepts mean? The Canadian Charter says everyone's got freedom of movement. All right, the Canadian province enacted a law to require everyone who finished medical school to spend a year providing medical services in a remote or regional area of the province. Struck down. Can't do that. Freedom of movement is protected in the Charter of Rights in Canada. Now, these are the distortions you get. Well, for all the problems with a messy elected parliament, you will rue the day when a Bill of Rights is enacted with a conservative court to interpret. Freedom of association, last example I'll use. You got freedom of association. That'd be a reasonable inclusion in a Bill of Rights. How can you have a Bill of Rights or a Charter of Rights that doesn't say you've got freedom of association? But what does a conservative judge make of that? What does a conservative court make of that? They strike down arrangements that protect the position of unions in the workplace, because they say union membership and preference to unionists is an interference with the right of free association. So that's my warning. And look, Gillian says people haven't been educated about it, but I've got to warn you, in public life, when people say we've got to have an education campaign to persuade people that socialism works, or whatever, or the Charter of Rights works, it's generally when they've lost the case. And the Charter of Rights, before Gillian's time, did spend $500,000 on a public education campaign designed to awaken the electorate to this need, but it didn't build public support. We've been through this, George Williams' campaign. It didn't build public support. There's no movement in the parliament to embrace it. And the reason is all the contradictions and paradoxes you get when you enact these words and leave the interpretation of these words to a court.
I desperately want us to keep going, but people are getting very angry at me because the next session's about to start. So what I'm going to do is say, before we wrap up, to give Gillian a moment's right of reply and then Bob a summation as well, because I know your instruction for us today was to be constructive, and I think that's what we want. So the element that I didn't get to was the role of citizens. We've talked about the parliament, we've talked about the judiciary. We haven't talked about the role of citizens. So perhaps if both of you could give a closing statement to a room full of citizens who hopefully can be people going out and holding on to democracy for us. Gillian?
Well, I think it's been wonderful to see so many people here today. And to be honest, wherever I go to speak on these subjects, I'm getting large numbers of small country towns, wherever I go, people coming out wanting to be informed about the kinds of things that I'm concerned about. They don't have to accept everything I say. They may be influenced by the kinds of judgments that Bob is making. But what I am finding, and today's an example of this, is there's a growing appetite in Australia for public debate, because Parliament has let us down. Parliament is not providing that. And somebody said to me... Somebody remarked to me the other day Q&A has become the modern equivalent of Parliament. It's a very good programme. Not always, but it can be a very good programme. So my answer is yes, citizen power. Yes, get people out. Because I find in the streets where people speak to me in supermarkets, on the tram, in the hairdressers, and they say, you know, go for it, do it. They may not always get the nuances of the arguments. I'm a bit of a lawyer. But what I say is Australians have now got to stand up for those principles and values that they know have underpinned our society. So I say, be bold, speak up, and make your thoughts and ideas clear. And we have some chance then of influencing your political representatives.
Thank you, Gillian.
Well, the victory goes to the people who turn up. If you turn up, you win. Didn't Bill Clinton say? He might have been plagiarising Woody Allen. 90% of success is simply turning up. 90% of success is simply turning up. Who turns up here at meetings of a resident action group, at the branch of the political party? I'm going to be a bit provocative. At the branch of the political party you despise less than the other one? Who turns up? Who turns up in their local MP's office with a group, say a dozen, or 20 people who feel like you do, to say, for example, we think you ought to consider seriously a Charter of Rights, if that's your position? You can't complain if you don't make an effort. I was addressing something as Premier once, and a young guy got up in the back of the auditorium and he'd announced the Carr record and repeated every canard and unjust criticism of my Athenian regime that has never been equal for its perfection in judgment and management. But it was a harsh indictment, and I said, look, I'm going to ignore what you said. I'm going to throw down this challenge. At the age I'm guessing you to be, I was president of Young Labour. I was burning with ambition to do something in public life, to promote my ideas. Here's my challenge to you. If you think the Carr record as Premier of New South Wales is appalling, you join the political choice, you join the political party of your choice. I knew he was a young Liberal. My antenna picked up that he was a young Liberal. I said, and you go into politics and 25 years from now, you be leading a government up in Macquarie Street and prove that it can be done differently. One of the great things about the last federal election, I went round working on booths, ended up in Western Sydney, and there was great spirit on the booths. I was there for 6 hours. I got the photos on the phone to show you. Terrific. Don't tell me there's not involvement, because the involvement was terrific. There was a big Sikh community group. They were running an independent candidate. So the Labor member, Michelle Rowland, had a big group of Sikh background Australians participating, saying, no, stick with her, we like her. And there were some terrific, lively young Liberals. Jobs and growth, jobs and growth. The thing I admired about them was that they'd set up their booth, this booth with posters. It was in Western Sydney. And they slept in the car overnight to see that my mob didn't pull the posters down. And I thought they're taking the process seriously. They're involved on the other side, youngsters involved in the political process. There was a guy supporting David Leinhelm, And he was a libertarian. He said, if Lionhelm loses, he said, it'll be a terrible setback for the libertarian cause in Australia. I thought that was amusing. We had a chat about his family in New South Wales politics. And it was terrific. The Green candidate, the Green Party candidate, was there all day. He didn't have workers to work for him, but he took his case seriously. And we had a discussion about areas where we were in agreement. The nature conservation agenda, for example. It was an advertisement for Australian democracy. It was a terrific day. If you want to challenge me, I got the photos, as I said, on my phone. A final story. I gave a speech not long ago to a group of young Palestinians. They said, our case doesn't get expounded. We've got no money. The other side, the pro-Israel case, is all powerful in Australia. Our case doesn't get a hearing. I said to them, victory goes to those who turn up. Turn up. Go and see your local members. Tell them the stories of your family, the dispossession of 1948. Tell them those stories. They'll be moved by those stories. But unless you turn up, unless you participate in that process, you'll live in a world of gripes and grievances. Turn up. Victory goes to those who turn up.